I can't hear your clapping to the Lord.
Amen. Thank you. God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Jehovah, the man of war, his mercy endureth forever. Jacob, the man of war himself, we worship you, we adore you, we lift you high. Father, be glorified in Jesus' name. Thank you for all you've done in our lives since the past 1 year. Thank you for your protection. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your love. Accept our thanks in Jesus' name. Father, during this week, in the lives of all your children, Father, do something special. Do something extraordinary. Do something you alone can do. And let the miracles begin tonight. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. And let someone shout hallelujah. Well, shake hands with one or two people and say good evening. God bless you. And then you may please be seated. God bless you. You are all welcome in Jesus' name. And I am delighted to see you again. To say congratulations to those who have graduated. And congratulations to those who will soon graduate. And then, congratulations to me, the father of them all. What does he say is the problem? Let somebody come and tell me what is the problem. Come and tell me what does he say is the problem. That's all right. I think we need to pray for him that God will have mercy on him. I get letters from all manners of people telling me that they are to be my successor. That's all right, that's okay. I even had a case of a woman who said she's a successor, and she packed her load, came to the house to say, "Okay, now you need to move out so I can move in." Hallelujah. Now you see the reason why you must be praying for me. Revelation chapter 5. From verse 1 to 5, I will try to be as brief as possible, but I appeal to you to pay attention to every word. Revelation 5:1-5. And I saw in the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book written within and on the backside, sealed with 7 seals. And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, "Who is worthy to open the book and to loose the seals thereof?" And no man in heaven, nor in earth, neither under the earth, was able to open the book, neither to look thereon. And I wept much, because no man was found worthy to open and to read the book, neither to look thereon. And one of the elders saith unto me, "Weep not. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has prevailed to open the book and to loose the 7 seals thereof." The theme of our conference this year is the Lion's Cup. That means the baby of a lion. Now, what determines the behavior of an animal is the seed of the father that is in that animal. For example, no matter how hungry a cat may be, it will not eat grass. Why? Because there is something inside a cat that says they don't eat grass in your generation. It will take a miracle for a cow to eat meat. Why not? Because in the generation of cows, they don't eat meat. There's something within the cow that says, no, meat is not your food. So a cow will die of hunger rather than eat meat. A cat will die of hunger rather than eat grass. In 1 John chapter 3, verse 9, 1 John chapter 3, verse 9, the Bible says, he who is born of God does not commit sin. He said he can't, because the seed of God is in him. And God is holy. Isaiah chapter 6 from verse 1 to 3. Isaiah 6, 1 to 3. The angels are always crying, holy, holy, holy God Almighty. A lion, a baby lion, is a lion, no matter how small. The elders have a proverb. An elephant will not give birth to a dwarf. The child of an elephant will always be an elephant. From the day a baby elephant is born, it's already bigger than any goat. From day one. So, if you are truly born of God, the seed of God is in you. That's one way of checking your salvation. There are things you cannot do because God can't do it. That's very important. Take note of that. Now, let's take a look at certain things that are definitely to be expected of a lion's cub. Because you are a lion's cub, if you are born again, because you are a child of the Lion of Judah. And the child of a lion must be a lion. Number one, a lion's cub is born great. From the day you became born again, your greatness is established. The Bible says so. 1 John chapter 4, verse 4. 1 John chapter 4, verse 4. Greater is he that is in you than he who is in the world. No matter how small you are, because the seed in you determines who you are. You are greater than anyone else in the world who is not born again. Because the seed that is in you is the seed of the one who is called the Most High, the Almighty. Psalm 91, verse 1. Psalm 91, verse 1. From the day you are born again, you have been born to reign. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 20. Ephesians 1, 20. And Ephesians 2, verse 6. Your Father is seated in the heavenly places, and you are sitting there with him. Physically, you are sitting in the old auditorium now. But spiritually, you are seated in the heavens. Next, a lion is born to win. A lion does not lose any battle. When other animals see him coming, they get out of the way. They don't want a fight with a lion. And according to Romans chapter 8, verse 37, Romans 8, 37, you are born to be more than a conqueror. You are born to win. Doesn't matter what the present situation may be saying. You're going to end up a winner. Because your father, the lion, said it loud and clear, I have overcome the world. A lion's cub is the most protected animal in the world. Any animal who wants to die, let him attack the baby of a lion. He won't live to tell the story. That's the truth. Pure and simple. In Deuteronomy chapter 28, you read it from verse 1 to 7. Deuteronomy 28 from verse 1 to 7. The Bible made it abundantly clear. If you behave the way a child of God is supposed to behave, anybody who comes against you one way will flee seven ways. You are born to win. A lion's cub is born to be heard. I can hear your pastor saying that when a lion roars, they hear from kilometers away. That's true. There is something in a lion. When he opens his mouth, what comes out causes everything around to shake. Which is why I'm not surprised that when we have several children of the Lion of Judah around, when they shout hallelujah, people will hear. The Bible says in Amos chapter 3, verse 8, Amos chapter 3, verse 8, it says, the lion has roared, who will not fear? I've said it before, I'm sure you've heard it at one time or the other. When some people want to begin a program, they spend quality time binding and loosing demons, etc., etc. But when I want to start my own program, all I do is ask you to shout. When we shout, we are informing. When we shout, we are informing all enemies of God that we are here, that they should get ready to go if they don't want to perish. One of the things that the Word of God say we should do constantly is that we should shout unto God with the voice of triumph. Thank you. thank you. Then you will have more opportunities to shout later on. I'm just trying to say the sound of a lion must be a noisemaker. Heaven is a noisy place. God himself said clearly that even if you don't know how to sing, know how to make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Thank you. Thank you. I'm sure by now the people on the camp will be wondering what's going on. But let me go on. I think you've already got that point. But the fact that a lion is born to roar is not just in praising God, it's also in preaching the gospel. We are supposed to go to the whole world, make so much noise that the people will pay attention to what we are saying. I was telling my children in the UK in this past month, I told them, I'm afraid. And they said, why, Daddy? So you are becoming like the mainline churches. You are praying like them. You hardly open your mouth now when you pray. Some of you tell me that the reason you are doing that is because you want to win the natives. Tell me, how many natives have you won by keeping quiet? They don't even know you are here. Every Pentecostal must be known for noise making. On the day of Pentecost, only 120 people prayed, and the whole city heard the noise. 120 prayed. The whole city heard their noise. And it was their noise that brought the people to hear the sermon. That led to a conversion of how many people? 3,000. If you don't take anything away from this convention, cry to God that He will give you a revival of noise making. You cannot keep quiet after you have been born again. You can't call yourself the child of a lion and can keep quiet in your place of work, in the churches, etc., etc. One of my daughters in Canada gave the testimony. She troubled everybody in the city, that whenever she traveled, these people in the city, they knew somebody is missing. What kind of trouble? Jesus loves you. You must give your life to Him. He wants to save your soul. When she goes to the bank, she will be talking. Hey, lady, keep quiet. No. I'm not asking you not to fill my forms. I'm just telling you that while you are doing it, I also have a job to be doing. I have a duty to tell you. They must label you a fanatic because you won't just keep quiet. One of my sons got into a taxi with some people. After some time, the people got into the taxi with him, told the taxi driver that they want to stop. They are dropping. But that's not where you said you are going. We want to escape from this noisemaker. And many people gave their life to Jesus Christ when we were doing boss evangelism as your pastors. We just won't keep quiet. The world must know that we are children of the Lion of Judah. And the son of the Lion of Judah is born to be heard. At least you must hear. After you have heard, you can take your own decision. All right, but maybe I should tell you one of the biggest points about the lion child. And that is that the lion's child is born with a killer instinct. Every child of a lion is taught how to kill, and the killer instinct is in him. If you see two lion cubs play, if you watch the television Animal Kingdom or whatever they call it, if you see two children of lions playing, their play is one trying to choke the other. We are playing. We are children of the same mother. I throw you down, I grab your throat. Not too hard, because I know you are my brother. The moment I leave your throat, you throw me down, you grab my... Because that's how to kill. That's how they play. They don't play by licking the back of each other. They grab the throat. Killer instinct. So what am I born again to kill? Judges chapter 14 from verse 5 to 6. Judges 14, 5 to 6. I am born again to kill destiny destroyers. We are to be gentle as a lamb. But we must know that deep within us is a killer instinct. If I see anybody who wants to destroy my destiny, that fellow must die. What am I born again with the instinct to kill? Acts chapter 5 from verse 1 to 11. Acts 5 from verse 1 to 11. I am born again with the instinct to kill anyone who wants to pollute my destiny. Destiny polluters. The church of God has just started. Miracles are beginning to happen. And then here came a man and his wife, Ananias and Sapphira. They wanted to pollute the church. They wanted to introduce hypocrisy into the church. They wanted to introduce lying into the church. Peter didn't pray, "Oh God, have mercy on them, forgive them." No, no. He killed them. And when he killed them, what happened to the church? The church grew. When you see somebody trying to introduce false doctrine into your fellowship, after you've advised the fellow and is not willing to listen, you call down fire and let the fire finish the job. What am I born with? Killer instinct to do. To kill. To kill destiny arresters. Mark 5, verse 2 to 20. Mark 5, 2 to 20. The madman of Gadara had the destiny to be an evangelist. Some demons gathered together to make sure that they arrest his destiny. When the Lord sent out those demons, he granted their request eagerly to enter into his swine so that they can drown. Every lion cub must have a deliverance ministry. The word of God is absolutely clear. Thou shalt not suffer a witch to live. What am I to have a killer instinct for? To kill destiny mockers. 2 Kings chapter 2 from verse 23 to 24. 2 Kings chapter 2 from verse 23 to 24. As soon as Elisha Thank you, Father. There are some people that you must not sympathize with when God visits them, because he's going to visit those who are determined to destroy your destiny. In 2 Kings chapter 2, 20 to 24, soon after it became clear that the destiny of Elisha is to carry a double portion of his master Elijah, some children began to mock him. Not all of them, but you know children, they see a lot of people doing one thing, they want to copy. And the man of God didn't say they are children. He dealt with those who are mocking him. People are going to mock you when from now you begin to live as a child of the Lion of the tribe of Judah. When you begin to command demons to leave, when you begin to call down fire on those who are not willing to yield to the perfect will of God, when you begin to tell that every obstacle in your way will melt, just as fire goes before God, they will mock you. And you will handle them the way they should be handled. Anyone trying to interfere with your destiny must not be treated gently. And I will tell you a story. I was so close. Some of the older ones probably heard it before. We've just moved to this camp. The Holy Ghost service was beginning to hold every month. Things were just beginning to pick up. And then all of a sudden, a woman came. And said God had revealed to her that I'm to be her husband. I said, I am married. I'm a pastor. He said, God told her. And she herself wasn't even single. And she wasn't the youngest woman in the world. I mean, one of her children is a manager in a bank. And she was a senior officer in WAEC. Sorry, ma, something is deceiving you. I am not your husband. Oh. I got a letter from her, one every day. We got to a stage, I told my secretary, don't bring this letter in anymore. To cut a long story short, I mean, I sent for the husband, I sent for the family members. Well, look at what this woman is saying. You know what the husband said? The husband said, there's no smoke without fire. Ah, are you saying that I am the one making the move? The matter got so bad, I had to go and get a senior police officer to tell her to stay away from here. She laughed. One night we came back from Ebutemeta, because we'll go to Ebutemeta for digging deep, etc., etc., and then come here to sleep. As soon as we arrived at the camp, I told my wife and children to go home. I wanted to branch in the office to do a little bit of work. As soon as my people got home, this woman was waiting and said to my wife, I know you are the one standing in my way. I will kill you. Finally, I went to London. I went to London to do something. And in those days, there were no mobile phones. I didn't tell anybody I was coming. They didn't know in London I was coming. I went to write our Sunday school booklet. I wanted to finish my work undisturbed before I tell our people in London. As soon as I opened the door and I entered the house, the phone rang. I picked up the phone. She said, welcome. I've been waiting for you. I am at such and such a bus stop. I will soon be with you. Ah. So I had to tell her, hey, you know the policeman here, that they won't take bribes. I will call the police. By the time you arrive, they will be here waiting for you at the door. At that stage, I had to say to the Almighty God, what do I do now? Everywhere I went, this woman knew where I would be going without my telling her. She's already waiting for me. And my daddy said, what did I ask you to do to mountains? Oh. Well, so I decided to move mountains. Every mountain in your path, you have to move them today. I didn't know how it happened, but by the time I returned to Nigeria, a couple of days later, they brought her dead body back. A lion must have a killer instinct born with it to kill anyone that wants to tamper with your destiny. But let me, I can go on and on, but this is supposed to be just to whet your appetite. The big ones, they will come and tell you deep ones. This one is just introduction. The biggest lesson you learn from a lion's cub, from my own perspective, is found in Psalm 34, verse 10. Psalm 34, verse 10. What does it say? The young lions do suffer lack. They get hungry, they lack with all their strength, with all their abilities. But they that seek the Lord will not lack any good thing. The biggest lesson, as far as I'm concerned, that I learned from a lion is that I must never stop seeking God. Oh, I'm a lion, born great, born to reign, born to be hard, with a killer instinct. But if I don't seek God, I will lack, I will suffer hunger. It's an individual decision. You must constantly seek God. Seek Him, you won't lack any good thing. I said that a lion is born to win. So was Samson. Even before he came out of his mother's womb, God has already prophesied he was going to judge the people of God. He was to begin to deliver the people of God from their enemies. He was born to kill. But when God left him, the one who was born to win ended up a loser. You must learn to seek God. God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. When we gather together like this and we are in the crowd, it is easy to shout when others are shouting, to pray while others are praying, etc., etc. What you do when you are alone makes all the difference. A group of us went to Kenya to attend a world conference of Pentecostals. A lot of people from Nigeria went. In those days, we have what we call pocket Bible, about the size of this smartphone. Small, you could put it in your pocket. I woke up early in the morning, went to the toilet to ease myself. Those days when you go to the toilet as a true child of God, you don't just go to ease yourself, you go to study the Bible. That's why the pocket Bible was so useful. And I opened my Bible and I did some study. And it was somebody flushing the toilet on the other side that brought me back to realize that, hey, you are in the toilet. So quickly I tied it up and I came out. And who do I see with his pocket Bible in his hand? Brother Kumuyi. He too has sneaked into the toilet. Because, you know, we are so many, those of us from Nigeria, they just put us in one of the classrooms in a body house, in one of the dormitories in a body house. And so there were all manners of noise. People came from the east, from the west, and they were cracking jokes. And I sneaked out to the toilet with my pocket Bible. And he sneaked out. I looked at him. I saw the Bible in his hand. He looked at me. He saw the Bible in my hand. And we laughed. The lion teaches. You may be young. You may be strong. You may be born to reign. You may be born to be heard. But if you don't seek the Lord, you will still lack something good. So tonight I want you to pray. And I don't want to, maybe I should. Like I said, there is something inside a lion that will not cause the lion to eat a creature. It is called the seed of the lion. If you are truly born again, there is a seed of God in you that will not cause you to sin. So if you are still sinning, in secret, and you want to join those of us who are true children of the Lion of Judah, I beg you tonight, throw away any form of shyness or timidity and come forward straight away to come and give your life to Jesus Christ. It doesn't matter what title they are calling you. You need the seed of God in you so that you can live this Christian life. If you say you are born again but you are still committing sin in secret, come. Maybe you are truly born again but you backslid, come. To be able to qualify as a seed of the Lion of Judah, your salvation must be genuine. Come and settle that one straight away. Come. Let's put pretense aside. Let's settle the issue of salvation. Genuine salvation. Hurry up, hurry up, hurry up. We wait for you for 30 seconds more. Anybody can pretend on the outside to be a lion, but is the seed there? The seed of God. That seed that makes you someone born for greatness. The greater one that must be in you, can only be in you if you are genuinely born again. All right, those of you who are already in front and those of you who are on your way, cry to God and tell him, Lord, I want to be a child of the Lion of Judah. I'm tired of pretending. Father, save my soul. Put your seed within me so that whatever you cannot do, I won't do anymore. Cry to God. Cry to God. And those of you who are on the way, if you are coming here, hurry up. This is a serious conference. This one is not the kind you will forget in a hurry. Lord, save my soul. I want that seed that will make it impossible for me to sin. I want that seed to be deposited in me today. Save my soul. Save my soul, O Lord. Cry to him. And the rest of us, stretch your hand towards your brothers and sisters and intercede for them. Leave them alone. If they want to kneel, let them kneel, please. Don't disturb this serious prayer. Lord, save my soul. Have mercy on me. I don't want to leave this place pretending anymore. I want the real salvation. The one that will make it impossible for me to sin. Have mercy on me, Lord. Save my soul. And please, let's intercede for them. That God himself will have mercy on them. And that the seed of God, the seed of the Most High, will be deposited in them today. Thank you, Lord. Glory be to God. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. My Father, my God, I want to give you all glory and honor for your word this evening. I want to thank you for this, your children, who have come forward to surrender their life to you. Please remember your promise that whosoever will come unto you, you will no wise cast out. Kindly receive them. Save their souls. Let your blood wash them clean. Let them become true children of the living God. Let the seed of the Holy One of Israel begin to dwell in them. Lord God Almighty, everything that belongs to true children of God, make available to them. Thank you, my Father, my God. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. Praise the Lord. Now I rejoice with you, but don't go anywhere. Stay where you are. The counselors will attend to you later on. Now I want you to be part of the prayer we want to pray now. The rest of us, are we ready to pray? That's not the way a lion will answer. You're going to cry to the Almighty God as if you are the only one here. And say, Father. you are not serious. Say, Father. I will seek you. And from this moment onward, anyone who tries to tamper with my destiny, let them be removed. Open your mouth and cry to God.
Let's continue to pray. You are a